finished grading the login lab, whichever one that is, whichever number that is. And folks paid better attention to details, but there were still a few sort of common mistakes that I would hope that you would pay attention to. And therefore, I deducted a few points, and you can go back for many of you, not necessarily everyone. You can go and but a lot of people. And it was funny. I think there was one person that, like, it was almost perfect, and like it was so good that I didn't have the heart to deduct like the small amount of points for it because they did everything else right. They just made one little slip up. But there's three main problems that I had with the lab. And again, how can I say this? In a way, I can kind of understand because you folks just adapted my example in many cases. On the other hand, my examples are not meant to be comprehensive, finished, etc. And therefore, you know, put yourself in the shoes of an actual user using this and go in and see, does it make sense to you? If you were actually a student logging in, is this how you would want it to behave? All right? So there were three main things that a lot of people omitted. And number one is password. User ID and password. Having a plain text box for password so that when you typed in a password, it could be seen. Would you want the login to work that way? Probably not, all right? I was going to say, would you want the Canvas logon to work that way? And it's like, well, probably not. Maybe you'd be hoping that someone would look over your shoulder, see your password, and do all your assignments for you, but that's probably pretty unlikely, so you probably wouldn't want it to work that way. What's the remedy for that? How do you make that a password box? That's a property of the text box. You go in the text box, and one of the properties is, I forget exactly how it's worded, but type of text or something like that, and one of the choices is password. And when you select password, then it echoes just dots. I guess it depends on what browser you're using, but it doesn't show that. So that's, again, that's a small thing, but my goal in this class, again, is not just to get stuff that, like, gets by and is adequate, you know. It's to destroy good code. And that's one thing that is very easy to do, but would be a big improvement. The other thing is no validation. All right? In other words, first thing I did on just about everyone is click the submit button without putting anything in. All right? Almost to a person, there's maybe a couple of folks, it blew up. Because it had a null value for something, and you tried to do a query with a null value, and it didn't like it, so it blew up. All right? Again, very small thing, but you know you don't want your code blowing up. And you know that there are going to be people that, for whatever reason, have an oversight or whatever, and click on that or whatever. Maybe, you know, whatever reason. But you don't want to get those kind of big, ugly, blowing up errors. So put validation on that page. All right? Validate the user ID and password. And you do that for number one, just to avoid getting the ugly error. And number two, to lessen the burden on your server. I mean, if they don't give you anything to log on, they can't possibly be logging on correctly, by definition. All right? And therefore, why burden your server trying to process a request like that? Let the client-side validation catch it and keep it from even submitting it to the server. So that's the second thing. The third thing was when you got the page to the classes. All right. If you've logged on, it showed you a list of the classes. I got for some people, and for many people, some variation of this. A page that had essentially a grid view with course ID, section ID, professor ID. Something like that. Would that make sense to anyone? No. All right. Therefore, you know, what would you want to do? You'd want to present it in a way that was understandable. First of all, I would say it'd probably be a good idea to put the person's name that logged on up there. All right. That probably is less essential because, of course, it's going to be you who logged on. On the other hand, it is something you could store in a session variable and remember and display on every page. And then the last thing is like something like that, you want to make it so it makes sense. So, you know, put the name of the course, the name of the professor, and things like that on the page. So that it's understandable. So if you look at it, the student's like, oh yeah, you know, let's say you're thinking about your fall, not fall, this is fall, your spring schedule. Oh yeah, I signed up for Intro to Android and System Development and Archery, all right? As opposed to I look at that, oh yeah, I thought I signed up for a course ID of 12 and here it's 6, you know? Doesn't make sense, all right? So those are three things. Again, I commented on some people something to the effect of, you may have literally done exactly what I said. All right. On the other hand, we should be a little beyond that. We should not just be looking at the absolute minimum that we can do to follow the requirements that are laid down, but create something that's good and create something that's workable. All right. So, again, you can redo this if you want, and remember this going forward for future assignments. I think that's it. You know. And these are the small things that separate something that's okay or adequate from something that's good. And air trapping, reusability, user friendliness, these are all things that sort of elevate an app from just being barely functional to being good. One thing I absolutely hate is, and you get this a lot from web developers that sort of turn their nose up at users. Something to the effect of like, well, my code works. Well, yeah, you know. I've had people tell me, yeah, that stuff's on our website. Well, yeah, and if you happen to hit the right combination of 37 clicks, you can find it, right? So the fact that your website or your web application does the job is far from the notion that it does the job well. All right, so we want to elevate and do the job well. All right, next thing. We have two more SQL operations to look at, and I'm going to review the SQL for both of them, and then we'll get into working in the .NET framework with them. And the two that we have are inserts and deletes. And what I want to do is I want to discuss the basic syntax of them and then discuss the stuff that can go wrong. What we've seen from the update is that we can prevent errors from happening several ways. All right? And let me rephrase that. We can prevent the user from getting an ugly error message several ways. One way we can do that is by the design of our form. All right. So in the case of the example we went over last time with the summer league, skill level was in another table and there was a foreign key created. All right. We use a drop-down to allow people to edit that information. Well, that, I hesitate to use the word prevent, because we could concoct a scenario where you would still get an error. But for the most part, that makes it close to impossible for someone to enter in an invalid code for the skill level. You're only allowed those however many choices have been defined in the database. So how you can't pick something that isn't in the database. All right. So by our form design, we can catch and prevent a lot of errors. All right. If it's a required field, for example, we can put validation on it, and that way they can't get past it and save it if they don't supply a value. So that's our form design. We can prevent errors. Other sorts of errors we can't necessarily prevent via our form design. For example, if we entered in a duplicate user ID. But we can catch those errors and handle them in a better way. And we saw that with the item updated event of the details view, where we went in and after the update was attempted, we looked to see if it was successful or not. And if it was successful, we let it go. Otherwise, we displayed an error message. All right. So we're going to take that similar strategy with deletes and inserts. First of all, deletes. Deletes are probably the simplest of all the SQL statements. Because deletes work like this. Delete from table where condition. Alright? You're deleting a whole row from the database, so you don't have to specify any columns. You're getting rid of the whole row completely. So in the case of our player table that we had, it might look something like this. Delete from player where player ID equals 12. Almost certainly we're going to want to have a where clause on our delete statement. Almost certainly. Why do I say that? What would happen if we did not have a where clause on our delete statement? It would attempt to delete everything. Notice I said attempt, all right? What keeps a delete from succeeding? Forgetting about syntax errors and you got a column name wrong and all that. What keeps an error? What keeps us, what makes us unable to delete something from a database?
Access.
Pardon me?
Access, like it won't let you delete it from the database itself. Like that just set up the integrity or whatever.
Yes, the referential integrity. And if there's a relationship defined between two tables, then you can't delete. Then depending on how the parameters are set, you may or may not be able to delete it. So for example, we have in our database a player and a skill level. And we have a skill level ID in the player table. All right? Again, that's how you implement a one-to-many relationship. The many side points to the one side. So we have a foreign key in the player table to point to the primary key of the other table. And so we go into relationships, we connect them, we draw a line between them. That doesn't establish the foreign key until we click enforce referential integrity. All right. When we do that, we have to choose between either restrict or cascade deletes. That's our two choices. Keep in mind that restrict and cascade work from the parent to the children. They don't work the other way around. All right? So in this case, what's relevant here is what happens when we delete a skill level. Do we delete all the players of that skill level or not? All right? We can delete a player and the skill level relationship doesn't come into play, right? The whole idea of this is we don't want to orphan any of the rows in our database. So one of two things. Let's say we have a skill level of 1 for advanced intermediate. And we have some players in here. And one of them, two of them are labeled as advanced intermediate. If I delete this row from this table, I can't leave these two people in the player table with advanced intermediate with a skill level of 1. I have two choices. All right. Either I don't let them delete this, or I cascade the delete and delete all the players that have that skill level. Now, in this case, what seems to be a more reasonable choice? Restrict or cascade?
Restrict.
Restrict, right? In other words, you know, if I'm creating a table for the Little League players or whatever, and I have 5 skill levels defined, I decide, no, wait a minute, I really only want 4 skill levels defined. Doesn't make sense if I delete one of the skill levels. Well, that means that Johnny and Susie can't play. All right, I delete their skill level, they're gone. So it makes sense in this case to restrict it. All right, to say, well, hey, you can't delete this until you've cleaned up all those people and assigned them to other categories. Now, we could do this. If this was like something we did a lot, all right, we could actually write a user interface to make it our life easy for it. To say, hey, transfer these people to this skill level. But again, thinking of this particular example, I wouldn't see a Little League doing something like this too often, right? It's not like something that they do every week. But the point is we could design a user interface to make it easy to transfer people to other skill levels, if it was something that we did a lot, all right? But the idea is we can't delete it from one table and leave the children in the other table. So our two choices are don't allow the deletion of the parent or delete the children as well. You have to look on a case-by-case basis of which one is appropriate to do. In database terms, they talk about dependent and independent entities, all right? An independent entity would be an example like this. That player is a player that's walking around regardless of what skill levels we have defined or have not defined, right? I mean, skill level is simply a way to classify those players, but it's not intrinsically tied to the player. We could categorize it a different way. An example of a dependent relationship would be when we have an order and order line items. Let's say you place an order with Amazon and you order Fallout 4. Well, first of all, what are you doing ordering it now? You should have had it, like, you should have, like, 3 special editions of it by now, right? But let's say you did, or you're buying it from for your nephew for Christmas or something. And then you order a book, and then you order, I don't know, a DVD. You have one order, right, that you went and you placed today, and there's 3 line items on that order, all right? Order 1, order 2, order 3. It doesn't make sense to delete the order, say, well, I want to cancel my order, but leave one of the line items still out there, all right?
of a dependent entity. And in a case like that, you probably would cascade deletes. So if you want to cancel your order, you just have a button that says cancel order. It would delete everything from the order table, as opposed to having to delete each line item individually. So you have to look through, the bottom line is you have to look through on a case-by-case basis and decide what's appropriate for it. Does it make sense or not? At any rate, that is what would make a deletion fail. And keep in mind, all right, that one restrict anywhere down the chain and you cannot delete. All right, a deletion either completely succeeds or completely fails. So for example, let's say there was a player statistics table. And there's a foreign key relationship, and it was set to restrict. And let's say we set skill level to player as cascade. Probably not a good idea, but just a hypothetical situation. If I went to delete a skill level, it would try to delete all the players. And if there's a restrict relation, if any of those players had a row in the player stats table, then the deletion of that player would be prohibited. And the entire delete would fail. So it's not like it's going to delete the ones that it can and leave the ones that it can't delete. All right? A delete statement either completely succeeds or completely fails. So with this restrict and cascade, anywhere down the line, if there's a restrict, even if there's a chain of 15 tables, if there's a restrict relationship and one of the rows has something in that 15th table that matches up all the way down the line, then you can't delete it. All right? So, that's what can go wrong with a delete statement. Now, how do you think we're going to code that? How are we going to accommodate that, do you think? We could accommodate this a couple of different ways. Let me tell you the ways that we could accommodate it. One way we could accommodate it is we could, when the page loads, we could run out and see if the skill level, let's use a concrete example. When the page loads, we could run out and see if the skill level has any players associated with it. And if the players had any, if the skill level had any players associated with it, we could disable the delete button. All right? That's one way we could do. Second way we could do it is when we click on the delete button, we leave the delete button there all the time. When we click on it, before it goes and deletes, tries to delete, we go out and run out and check to see if there's any players related to that skill level. And if there are, maybe we display a list of players for that skill level. That's a second option. All right? A third option would be to let it go and try to delete it and then just display a user-friendly error. All right? Now, if you think about it, it's a case of how much work are you going to do? How common are deletions for this? All right. Either of those ways is acceptable. All right. The approach that we're going to take, for the most part, will be to let it try and delete it, and if it doesn't work, we'll display an error page or something saying that you can't delete it, all right? And we'll play around with that a little bit, all right? Let's go in and let's do deletions. I was going to talk about inserts first, but let's go and do deletions because those are pretty straightforward. All right. So let me go and load up what we were working on. Oh. create a grid view, because we haven't done a grid view yet with updates and deletes. I'm going to go and create a grid view for that skills level. Now, would this be something that anyone would be allowed to edit? No. This would be an administrative thing. I'm not going to put that code in here, though. I'm not going to put the code in that looks to see if you're administrator first. You could easily do something like that through the login process. Through the login process, in addition to seeing if it's a valid user ID and password, you could look to see if they are flagged in the database as an administrator. And if they are flagged as an administrator, then you would set a session variable that says, yes, this person is an administrator, and you'd give them access to these pages. All right? I'm not going to do that, though. But it should be easy enough to do. All right, let's pull down. First of all, let's look in the database. Relationships. There's a line drawn between these. And if we look at that, it is click to enforce referential integrity. That means that we do indeed have a foreign key relationship. You can draw the line between them without clicking that. I don't know why you would want to do that. I can only think of a couple very specialized reasons why you'd want to do that. And even then, that would sort of be like a transitional thing. Like, until you cleaned up the data, you would not enforce referential integrity. You'd go get rid of all the errors, maybe after you've imported some spreadsheets, and then you would click on to enforce referential integrity. But you need that for it to be a foreign key. The shorthand way of telling is, if you see the lines with the numbers, then it's defined as a foreign key. One to many. Again, students have asked me, have said something like access has gotten it wrong. It's supposed to be one to many in another direction. Access did not get it wrong. You got it wrong. All right? Because access is smart enough to know that if this skill level here points to the primary key here, there can only be one thing on this end that matches up with it. And therefore, it knows that the one side of the relationship is over here. And the many is there. So if you see something that looks incorrect, then look at your database design. If we look here at the relationship again, we are not cascading delete. All right? Which means the opposite of cascading. Not cascading means restricting. Which means that if I go in here and try to delete that, I will not be able to do that. If I set it to cascade, I'll get a warning saying you're also going to delete X number of players. All right? Okay, so let's build a grid view that we could go and edit our skill levels. Remember, the grid view and the details view work very, very, very similarly. So what we've said before about updates on a details view also work with the GridView. But the only difference is that the GridView does not have a insert mode. So I'm going to go and create a new page. That I'm going to call skill levels. Good measure, I'm going to set it as a start page so I don't have to navigate to it. I'm going to go and create my data source in GridView. This should be all old hat for you by now. What connection string do we want? We want the one that we've been using. I am going to be lazy today, because today is my Friday. Alright? And I'm going to say I'm going to let it do it to me automatically. And I'm going to order by the sequence code. Right? That was the whole purpose of the sequence code, is to be able to put them in a sequence different than alphabetical order or the primary key order. Now, I'm going to click Advanced. And I'm going to click Generate, Insert, Update, and Delete Statements. Alright. It says Insert. It doesn't know that we're going to tie this to a grid view. So we won't be able to insert, but it's going to generate the SQL anyhow. You could actually tie this to a details view as well. Use optimistic concurrency. We're going to ignore that for now. All right. I click OK. Next. Test the query. There we go. Finish. Then I go and I associate this grid view with that. And for good measure, I'll click Enable Editing, Enable Deleting. All right, let's run this. Between this and a details view starts off as read-only mode by default. Alright? I can then put any individual row into edit mode. This is one thing that is a little bit of a weakness of this approach, I would guess, is that you're editing a row at a time. Maybe that's not a weakness. Maybe that's a good idea. Anyhow, I click edit, and the things that I can edit go into a text box by default. What if I don't want them in the text box? What if I want to add validation? It becomes a template column, just like with the details view. So I go in and I change beginner to rookie, click update, and there it goes and changes it. Now, I go and try to delete this guy. Should I be able to? No, because I'm advanced. Boom. Record cannot be deleted or changed because the table player includes related records. All right? Which is what we'd expect to have happen, right? Because we saw that happen in Access. The problem is we don't want to give our users this kind of ugly error message. All right? Now, again, depending on the specific problem, there's a lot of things that we could do, but probably the most straightforward thing to do is let it try to do the deletion and then catch it if there is a problem. There's something else I didn't really like about this. you like about what just happened, other than the fact that I got a big ugly error? Never asked me to confirm, right? Deletions being a destructive operation probably should ask you, are you sure you want to delete? All right. So these are two things that we can address. All right. First thing we're going to do is address the deletion issue of getting the error. Now, based on what we saw with the update, how do you think we're going to handle this? Taking the approach of let the deletion fail, catch the error, and display a message.
Item deleted event.
Right. Remember, we looked at a list of events available, and there was on item updating, on item updated, on item inserting, on item inserted, on item deleting, on item deleted. The ones that end with the ED, the past tense ones, are the code that's going to execute after the statement has been attempted. And we can then go and look at the properties of the argument to that method. Again, this automatically gets called through the framework. Right? This is our hook where we can put our code in. So we can look at those properties and see if a problem occurred. And based on whether a problem occurred or not, we can deal with it. We can do something. So I'm going to go in the code behind here. That's not where I want to go. I want to go into the code here. Now, when I'm done with this, we'll come back and we'll look at the code in more detail. All right? Right now, this is a simple enough case, and therefore, we don't have to worry about it. All right. Now, grid view. We go into here. And we can say on item row deleted. Alright. I lied. It's on item deleted on the details here. They just had the messy up by giving it a different name, didn't they? What jerks. Who has Gates' email address? I'm going to drop them a line and say, look. So I click on row deleted. Equals. And then I say create new event. Now it's important that you go through this procedure. All right, you can't just jump into the code behind and start writing the method. Because remember, we have to wire the method to the .NET control so that when a row is deleted, our code gets called. So if we just went in and created an on-row deleted method in our code behind, that may be well and good, but it wouldn't be then wired to the grid view so that when a row was deleted from it, this code went on. So I click create new event. And it says grid view 1 row deleted. Let me go up here and put a label for an error message. And our code is going to be pretty much identical to what it was before. We're going to look to see if this E variable has an exception. Now notice this is a different class than we had before. It's a grid view deleted event argument. I think the other one was a details view updated event argument. All right, so you get back a little bit different information depending on the specific event that happened, but there's a lot of commonality. In other words, one of the properties of this is that there's if there's an exception or not. So I can look and say if E dot exception not equals null, then I know there's a problem, right? Not equals null means that it is something other than a null, which means that there is in fact an exception. So an error has occurred. So if an error has occurred, I can put label one dot text equals cannot delete. Now again, knowing what we know about SQL and this particular database table, we can pretty much assume that one of two things is the problem. All right? Thing one is that there's a player in the player table for that skill ID. Thing two is that something catastrophic happened with the database and we simply can't connect. Of those two scenarios, thing one is the most probable. So we can phrase our error message that way. Now that I mentioned thing one and thing two, I'm going to be thinking of Dr. Seuss all day. All right. But anyhow, cannot delete likely cause players exist of that skill level. Now, we'll leave it at that. The last thing I want to do is I want to tell the framework that I got this one. All right? You don't have to worry about this problem anymore. So I set the exception handled attribute to true. That simply tells the framework, we have handled the exception. You no longer need to worry about it. All right? If you don't do that, it will run our code, and then it will run the system code, and you'll get the big ugly error message anyhow. So you have to tell the framework that you have handled the exception. All right, so now when we run this, we go and try to delete it. Cannot delete. The likely clause players exist of that skill level. All right.
Can we add color to that so the error message is red?
Absolutely. Okay, so how would we do that? Well, we could do that any way that we have we could do that obviously using CSS. How are we going to do that though? Let's look. Remember, the key to answering these how can I add style to this is usually let's look at the HTML and see the HTML that's generated. Then from there we can figure out the style that we want to do. So if I click delete, I get the error message. I'm going to do a view source and I'm going to see that the error message is in a span with an ID of label 1. All right? So, what I could do is I could create a style rule for the ID of label 1, all right, and then do anything I wanted to with it. Make it bigger, make it red, whatever. The other thing I could do is I could assign this a class. which is what I'm going to do. Why do you think I'm assigning it a class instead of an ID? Yeah, because I could, as I'm developing this page, have a variety of different error messages that I put on different places and so on and so forth. So therefore, if I want my error messages to look consistent, I'll create a class. IDs are, especially with HTML5 and the new tags that have come into play in HTML5, IDs are fairly rare. You really don't need to use them a lot unless there really is one very special thing on the page that you want to style differently. You used to use IDs to differentiate between your nav section and your header section and your body of your page and so on. Now with HTML5, you can simply use the nav tag or the header tag or the section tag. All right, now that I've done this, I can go and put a CSS file. So I will create a new CSS file. And I will put for class of error. Font size 1.2m. Color. Notice I'm not just making it red, I'm making it red and bigger. Alright? That is an accessibility issue for people that are colorblind. Anyone hear about the colorblind issue regarding football?
Oh, yeah.
Alright? What was that all about? Two teams were playing and they were using like their crazy jerseys, and there was like one with red and one with green. And if you have that particular kind of colorblindness, you had no idea who was on which team. Because all the jerseys look the same, all right? So again, had the NFL owners watched my lectures, which I encourage them to do, all right, I encourage everyone to do, they would have known that they should have done something different with the jerseys besides just making them the same color, all right? So for example, they could make one, red and long pants, one red and short pants. Okay, I'm just making that part up. All right. That's probably just a bad idea all the way around. But, you know, if you think about it, the normal default is that one team wears a color, one team wears a white jersey. And that even people that are colorblind would not have difficulty distinguishing. All right. Last thing I have to do is I have to go and apply this style sheet to my page. So I'll go in.
Google.
Yeah, I just copy paste from my other
stuff. Right. I have done this so many times that I think I am at the point of remembering it.
Maybe one day I'll remember it. Maybe
one day.
One day. Until then, W3 schools will be where I go.
Yeah. And see, that's, in my mind, that's fine. You know, I mean, it'll take you 2 seconds to Google it. You know, why have that occupying valuable space in your brain when you can Google it? Now, if you don't know anything about creating an external style sheet file, well, then you're doomed, right? But if you know about that, and you know that you can link it, the specifics of how to link it, yeah, look that up. All right. So now we go and can give a bigger error message. All right, as promised, let's look at the code that got generated. And let me try to stretch the boundaries here to get the most space. All right, there's our grid view. We've seen that before.
data key name, skill level ID, data source ID, and all that. That's nothing earth-shattering. Our SQL data source has all the connection strings and all that. It has a delete command, an insert command, a select command, and an update command. So the update command we've seen before, and it knows to do the update of the fields that are not read-only, and it knows to use the skill level as a primary key. Remember, we decided before that your update, you should have all your non-read-only, that is your editable field, should always be in your update, and they should be in the same order. Although, because this has update parameters, I'm not sure same order is critical. All right. Select statement, we've seen that. Insert statement, we'll look into in a little bit. Delete command. Delete from table where skill level ID equals question mark. Now, here's the one thing that's a little different from this. Because we let it generate it, now we get the delete parameters. And the update parameters and the insert parameters. Because the other one that I coded, I didn't have those parameters, and therefore it depended on the sequence to match things up. Here I can explicitly say the first parameter comes from the skill level ID. And what type is it? It's an int32. Okay? So that ties. That's why I'm thinking the order doesn't matter so much as long as you have the parameters. And the update parameter is the same thing. It specifies what things go where. All right, questions about this so far? Now, the one thing I still don't like is the fact that when I tried to, as soon as I click delete, it goes and tries to do the deletion. I would think that we'd want it to confirm. Well, this again is deviating from the default behavior, right? Therefore, we need to make this column a template column. So I'll go here, say, edit columns, command field, convert to template. Now, I can look at and see, edit templates, there's the different things that I have. This is a guy I want to change. Alright. I want this to invoke something first. There's an onClient click method, which we're going to use, which makes sense. We're going to want this to happen client-side, right? Because why send it to the server simply to ask for a confirmation? That's something that the user can supply right then and there. It shouldn't require a round trip to the server. So I'm going to pop up a little alert box, and I'm going to ask it, hey, is it okay to delete? Now, do you folks feel lucky today, or no? I sound like Clint Eastwood.
Sure.
I think the method to do that is confirm.
That's it.
And I want to say return.
Pardon me?
What does it say there in blue?
On client click. So now when I go and click this, if I did it right, and I am in fact lucky. I need to put quotes around these things. I need to put quotes around the big instruction too. Now I go and delete. Uh-oh. I guess I'm not lucky. In fact confirmed.
Can you use a semicolon at the end of it?
When in doubt, look at the source code. Sure, it's something silly with my guess is, I don't know what my guess is. Let's try this. There we go. Do I want to delete? Cancel. Do I want to delete? Okay. And then that catches it. All right. Not much more to say about the delete other than this. Well, except when does not having anything to say ever stop me from going on, right? What, again, depending on the nature of the problem that you're trying to solve, if deleting from this table was a common occurrence, you could develop a user interface that instead of just displaying a message, you could actually run out and retrieve all of the players that had that skill level. You could actually redirect them to another page and say, here's the reassigned players to different skill level page. And you could actually create a user interface to go and you could assign all the players in one swoop to another skill level. Maybe every advanced intermediate we're going to say is an intermediate, all right, or is advanced. Or maybe we could choose one at a time and make this person advanced, this person intermediate. The point is sometimes when you develop database constraints, you think, well, gee, I can't delete it without going in and changing every one. That's true. On the database level, that's a true statement. However, remember that on the UI level, you can go in and make your life easier. If this, again, if this was something that was done often. So, in this case, thinking about what we're doing here, I'm guessing that this would not be something that would be done terribly often. That we could have a page that allowed us to pull up a person of a skill level and see all the people associated with them. All right. And in that way, we could go in and we could view and assign the people to a new skill level. That might be a good thing for us to look at. Well, I don't know. We'll see. Possibly we'll look at it next week. Questions? All right. All your assignments have been posted. All right. And in addition to that, you know, you have your project. Keep in mind that the individual assignments are meant to have you use certain techniques and know how certain techniques work. Your project is your chance to sort of assemble all those techniques and figure out when to use each one of them and piece together a semi-completed application using this, using the tools that we learned. If there's something that you do not know how to do that you are interested in for your project, you can either email it to me and we can maybe spend some class time on it, or I could talk with you individually. Questions? All right, we'll see you over lunch.